Wait.
Hi guys, Amores here with a Windows Millennium update video. A few months ago, I tested the Windows ME on a modern configuration. All good, except the installation was not possible at the moment, so I had to use a pre-installed copy of Windows from another PC. To run Windows ME on a very modern system, we need to enable MS-DOS mode first. And this can be easily done using an unofficial patch, but it works only after Windows is installed. MS-DOS mode is not actually required to run a Windows Millennium, but we need the Windows ME to process the autoexec bat and the CREGFIX patch, or else we will run into vcache Windows protection error. If you are not familiar with CREGFIX, this is a tiny patch made by low-level programmer Mintsuki, and it will simply fix the vcache error. While the original CREGFIX can be loaded via autoexec bat, the VXD version can be loaded using the system ini file, like any other Windows real mode driver. Without further ado, let's perform a fresh install of Windows Millennium. I will use a SATA M.2 SSD and some adapter so it can be plugged into a regular SATA port. This was originally a Windows 10 drive, so we have to delete all and create a fresh FAT32 active partition. The disk management tool will perform this task with just a few clicks. Anyway, the recovery partition needed some extra care, so I had to use a diskpart/clean command to make it disappear. While we can create non-standard FAT32 partitions, this is not exactly a good idea if we plan to use it with Windows Millennium, so let's not go over 32 gigabytes. Next, let's make sure that our FAT32 partition is made active, and once we are done, we are ready to copy the necessary files. We can download the original Windows Millennium ISO from WinWorld PC. For the installation, we don't need the whole CD, but just the Win9X folder. We need also CREGFIX VXD, and we may want to use PatchMem by Rudolf Law, but this patch is not actually required this time. Next, we have to create a DOS bootable USB stick. We need it twice, first to make our SSD bootable, then during the Windows ME setup. Right after the first restart, we have to boot one more time, and we have to edit the system ini file. For this job, we can use unit booting and a DOS bootable floppy image with FAT32 support. Now it's time to make our partition bootable by using a sys command. Next, we have to create a fresh config sys file and put in charge HiMemSys as a memory manager. At this point, all the necessary files are either already copied on our C drive or can be retrieved from our DOS bootable USB stick, which acts like an actual Windows 98 boot floppy disk. Once we are done with editing config sys, we have a bootable SSD ready for Windows Millennium setup. We have to reboot so we can start the installation straight from our SSD and not from USB. This is the most compatible way to do it. As usually, the first part of the installation will simply work. The problems will come to us after the first restart. First, because we have too much RAM than Windows was designed to handle. And second, we need CREGFIX to set the right flags in some CPU registers, or we end up with the vcache error screen. But since we already know that the setup will run into these errors, right after the first restart, we won't continue the installation by booting from our hard drive. Instead, we will boot from our USB stick and make all the necessary modifications. Then we have to restart and the setup will continue without a single error. Unless there is something wrong with our hardware, but this is not the case with this configuration. Now, all we have to do is to edit system ini file inside Windows folder, where we have to add two lines under 386ENH section. The classic max fizz page line that will limit the amount of physical RAM available to Windows, And the next line is of course related to CREGFIX. Well, to make Windows Millennium run CREGFIX, we have to type device equals CREGFIX.VXD, and Windows will look for this driver into system folder. So let's make sure that CREGFIX.VXD will be there at the next restart. Well, that's it. After restart, we can continue the installation normally without any errors. In fact, I'll put the uncut footage with the second part of the installation. Uncut means that you will see some blue screens when the resolution changes or the signal is missing. This part of the installation takes about 5 minutes, so the footage is sped up about 5 times. So in about 1 minute, I will get back to you with the driver installation part. So let's install some drivers for this Windows Millennium setup. I will swap my 7900GS card with a NVIDIA FX Quadro 3500, which is basically the very same card under a different name with a silly launch price of $50.99. Installing NVIDIA 6 and 7 series cards in Windows 98 or Millennium is a bit more complicated. Depending on model, we need 8269 NVIDIA modified driver and one or more patches made by Rudolph Law. I will put a link into the description. So far so good, the video drivers worked. FX Quadro 3500 is actually clocked a bit slower than a stock 7900GS. Now let's install some sound drivers. These are not complicated at all to install, especially when using a PCI Advanced Logic ALS 4000. Now let's make a quick benchmark using Quake 3, a game released in December 1999, and this game was like a mandatory benchmark when Windows Millennium was released. This is less than what 7900GS can do, but almost 700 FPS, I guess it can be bad. How about 32-bit disk drivers? No problem, we can install AACI drivers made by Rudolph Law. Right now the M.2 SATA installation drive and the regular SATA 3 SanDisk drive that I connected later are both handled by BIOS. Our SATA controller is just an unknown PCI device for Windows 98. We have to identify which one, and then we can manually install AACI drivers. Using a program like Hardware Info will make this job easier. We just have to look what resources is using our SATA controller, and we just found it. This driver has two options, AACI 4 for motherboards with 4 SATA ports, like this one I'm using right now, or AACI 6 for motherboards with 6 SATA ports. At the next restart, we not only get crazy disk transfer speeds for a PC running Windows ME, but now we are using a protected mode driver, so our system is not running in MS-DOS compatibility mode anymore. Now that we have proper drivers, we can do some disk benchmarks, but let's check first how our CPU is doing. With such competition, of course, is doing great in CSoft Sandra 99. In the end, let's see what are the crazy speeds I have mentioned before. Our SSD drive is seen as removable, and it is compared with other removable devices. But at over 300 megabytes random write speeds, we know this is like 20 times faster than a good hard drive that was in service with Windows Millennium. Not to mention the access time. Besides AACI drivers, you know what else would be nice to have in Windows Millennium? USB support. Well, we cannot initialize the onboard controller because, of course, it's too new, but we can use some older PCI card with the help of a PCI Express to PCI adapter, or even better, we can use a PCI Express to USB 2 controller. This card uses a VIA6212 USB controller, and it will be recognized by Windows Millennium as a standard USB 1.1 controller. This is a good start, but we need USB 2 support for USB 2 devices like a Wi-Fi adapter. Once we have installed the updated VIA USB 2 drivers, USB 2 devices will show up. Otherwise, they won't even be listed in Device Manager as some unrecognized devices. Now that we have USB support, we can use standard USB audio devices like these Jabra headphones released in 2016. This way, we can skip a dedicated PCI audio card, but if you ask me, I will always go for a PCI sound card. Now let's go back to the Wi-Fi adapter that was discovered earlier after installing a USB 2 driver update. This adapter uses a Zydus 1211 chip and it's very easy to install. Its own software is designed to connect to any unencrypted network that is in range, something that today would be considered outrageous from a security standpoint. Anyway, this means that once the drivers are installed, we are already connected to the internet because I do have an unencrypted wireless network around. Why not? All that we have to do now to serve the web is to specify that we are connecting through our local area network and we don't even have to open control panel or make any other settings. Thanks for watching. Stay tuned for the next video. Maybe consider to hit that subscribe button. I will leave you now with some internet action using the included Internet Explorer 5.5 and Retrozilla. All this while playing one of my favorite tunes, The Alibi by Laxity.